Hello friends, I am Vikas Divyakirti and I am one of the faculty members of Drishti IAS. Drishti IAS has been working for so long in Hindi medium, and now from this year 2019, we are starting a new journey towards English medium. We have a magazine in English for last 3 years, we have a website in English called drishtiis.com, and now a YouTube channel which you are viewing the video on, that is Drishti IAS English. So on this channel we are bringing some playlists to ease out your preparation, to make your preparation easier. And one of the playlists which we are starting from this video will be called Interview Insights. In this program, what we are aiming is, we'll discuss all the difficult questions which are generally asked in the UPSC interviews and the questions which give you stress, which give you pain while preparing. So, in the very first video, I am going to discuss 3 questions which are supposed to be the most tricky questions of UPSC interview. The first question is, define yourself or introduce yourself. This seems to be a very easy question, but when asked in the interview, it turns out to be the most difficult question, because it's very difficult what to say about myself and what not to say about myself. And in the given situation, in the given time, when 5 senior most members of the Indian bureaucracy and academics are sitting in front of you, and you cannot waste their time, you have to be very precise, you have to be very simple in your communication. So it becomes very difficult that what should I tell about myself and what should I not tell about myself. So we'll discuss in brief what you should say in this question. The second question is, why do you want to join civil services? And this can specifically be about IAS or IPS or about the civil services. Why do you want to join the civil services? And third, this is your choice that you are willing to join civil services, but then they can come to their point also. They can ask you, why should we select you? So we will be starting with these 3 questions, and you are most welcome to write more questions which you think we should discuss on this platform in the comment section of this video, so that our team is able to know what is bothering you. And I think we can bring many videos on these questions, and we can bring at least 10-15 videos on different questions which are difficult ones. So let us start with the very first questions. Define or introduce yourself. When you are in the UPSC interview, you must understand what you can say there and what you should not say, what you shouldn't say. The 5 members sitting in front of you are very busy. They are not interested in unnecessary or unwanted details about you. But in the initial days of the interviews, they generally don't ask define yourself. And the reason is, when the members are new in the interview, they have sufficient questions in their mind to ask from different candidates. They come prepared, they have a list of questions in their mind, they ask you. After some days, they start feeling that the questions are being repeated again and again. So, to avoid the repetition of questions, they ask the candidates to define themselves, because when they define themselves, when they speak about themselves, they give some clues, or even if they don't give the clues, the members are able to catch some clues from their answers to initiate the discussion. And once the thread starts of discussion, then they are very comfortable in taking the discussion into many fields, many areas, and then they are easily in a position to assess your personality with the questions which have come from the discussion you initiated. So the first point is, while introducing yourself, you should not say anything which you do not want to have in the interview in detail. So all the difficult areas which you think you want to avoid, you should not discuss in the introduction about yourself. This is the very first point. Or, if you believe that even if you don't say, they will catch that point from your DAF and you want to avoid that point in the beginning itself, then you can use that point in the introduction itself as a weakness you are having, so that once it is said, most of the times they won't be asking the same question because you have already said that you are not comfortable with that area. I'll tell you how. But you have to say very brief things which you think they should know about you while discussing with you. Like your name, they know very well already. So, you are not supposed to repeat your name, or if you feel comfortable, you can start with this sentence. Dear sirs, as you know, my name is XYZ. You can start with this. Now, I have taken many mock interviews. Some of the students use their parents' name in the introduction. I am XYZ, I am son of Mr. ABC and Mrs. DEF. That is not required. Because always understand, they are not free people. They are not free to listen to everything you want to say. You tell only what is important for their understanding of you. So, don't discuss your parents' name. Don't discuss your village name. Don't discuss the name of your school. Don't discuss the name of your school. What you can say is, you can tell the name of your district plus your state only in one sentence. I am XYZ and I come from D district of the F state. After this, they are most likely interested in your educational background. So, your educational achievements, I am not willing to say that you have to say that I have been a very meritorious student, I have earned distinctions in academics. No, don't say about yourself, it doesn't look good. Just introduce yourself that, sir, I have done my M.Tech from this university, or I have done my M.E. from IIT, or whatever the university you are having. I have done my graduation from DU and then I went to JNU for pursuing my post-graduation. That's all. The name of the university, from where you have taken your latest degree, and the name of the degree which is latest, or at least, or at the most I can say, or at the most the last two degrees which can define your personality, that is more than required. After this, you can tell your hobbies. If you have any work experience or you have already been selected somewhere, so you must tell in one sentence only. So, in a way, if I have to introduce myself, I would say 3 to 4 sentences. Sir, my name is XYZ. I belong to X district of Y state. I have done my BSc and MSc. BSc from A university and MSc from Y university. My hobbies are A, B and C. I have done 2 years work in this industry and this was the name of my company and I was working on this designation. And as far as the UPSC is concerned, I have already been selected in IRAS or IRTS or IRS and now I am trying to get into IAS. Or earlier selection also includes if you have done anything else. I have been selected as a lecturer in Delhi University, or I have been selected as a software engineer in IBM, and now I am pursuing UPSC Civil Services. This is all they want to ask you, and some of the candidates even speak about their date of birth. Sir, my name is this, my date of birth is this, my mother's name is this, my father's name is this, my village is this, my school from where I took my education of class nursery to 5 was this, then 6 to 8 I went to this school. No, that is not meaningful. So, be specific, be smart and leave the clues you want to leave, like For example, you want them, let us take an example, you have been a resident of suppose a district which is called Prayagraj now, and earlier it was Allahabad. You want them to ask questions on this name changing. If you want them, you will say, I belong to Prayagraj, which used to be Allahabad earlier. And if you don't want them to ask questions, then you would say, I belong to Allahabad or I belong to Prayagraj, that's all. So, while introducing yourself, give stress on the areas you want them to ask you. And that is the smartness, how you give your clues for the interview. And that is the way how you can navigate the interview of yourself. In hobbies also, you must speak something which may interest them. So, if that is done, I think your introduction about yourself is finished, and a good introduction, because whenever they ask, introduce yourself, this is the very first question of the interview, and generally they won't ask this question in between the interview or in the end of the interview. So, a good start of the interview helps you a lot. At least it gives you confidence, and this confidence creates better situations of a good interview. Now, why do you want to join the civil services? Again, one is what to say, and second is what not to say. I have taken many interviews, and many of the candidates in those interviews, they have a very poor answer for this question. Now, some of them would say, I want to do social service, and for doing social service, I think this is a good platform. And when they say this thing, it seems that they are taking themselves, they are looking at themselves like they are a very great social servant, maybe like Mother Teresa, maybe like Mahatma Gandhi. When you tell about yourself that you are going to be a very great social servant, it doesn't look good in the interview. You have to be simple, you have to be down to earth, you should not be self-boasting in the interview. So, when you say, I want to do social service, members perceive that you are telling a lie. They don't take it seriously. Because they very well know that in the interview, in the 30 minutes of the interview, you have come prepared for a lot of questions, and you won't speak from your heart, you will speak from your mind. And when speaking from the mind, you know what to say, what not to say. And that is why every word you say there will not be believed as you say. They will use their cognitive skills, they will use their judgmental skills to understand what is the reality and what is the pretension. So, don't pretend to be a great person, and greatness spoken about oneself is not a greatness. That's a weakness. So, don't say, I want to serve the society, serve the nation, I want to change the nation, I want to develop the nation, and that is why it is necessary for India to have me in civil services. Don't say such things. Second can be the real reason. I think in at least 70-80% cases, the reason is very selfish one. One wants to get into civil services. I am again saying it's about 70% people, maybe 30% people are going in the civil services with missionary zeal. Maybe the percentage is not 30%, maybe it is 10%, 5%, whatever it is. Reason for most of the persons going into civil services is power. Their passion towards power, their passion towards prestige, and for some cases who want to earn a lot of money through civil services, through corruption, maybe they have the reason that they will be able to earn very good money without initiating an industry, without taking a risk, without taking an entrepreneurial risk. They will be earning like an entrepreneur who has done a good startup. But that cannot be said. Even if you are having such mindset, you are not supposed to say this in an interview. This is what the interview board is supposed to get from you, what is your real motive behind the civil services entry. So, these points you should not say. What to say? Generally speaking, you must be honest to the extent the honest answer can be given. Sometimes the honest answer cannot be given. So, there only, in rare cases, you are supposed to give some answer which is not exactly the real answer you have in your heart or mind. So honesty generally works in the interview. So first point is honesty. And if you are a very normal person, normalcy, I should say, is another important thing. Normalcy. Be a normal human being. Don't be extraordinary. Be an ordinary human being. An ordinary person of the age between 20 and 30 who has ordinary interests, who has ordinary intentions, wishes, desires, that is what they want from you. Having these two things in mind, what should be the right answer? Why do you want to join civil services? One, first is because civil services are good. And why are they good? You have to answer in two, three points. You can say, sir, in civil services, or madam, in civil services, the most attractive thing for me is the diversity it provides me. In any job of the world, after some time, one has to go through the feeling of alienation, which means you are no more interested in working in that job. You have been alienated from yourself, from your job. Monotony is something which eats up the human being in the long run. Whatever you do, after some years of doing that consistently, you get bored. You don't enjoy that work. The only job which can always satisfy you is the job which gives you diverse options. In IAS, you always have diversity. Sometimes you are the SGM, sometimes you are the DM, then you are the commissioner, and after that, a lot of diversity. You can be a director in the health ministry, you can be a director in the education ministry, whatever suits you. Then you have become joint secretary in defense ministry. Then you become additional secretary in home affairs, then you become secretary in some other ministry. In the long run, you have so many departments to work in, and at the higher level, once your interests and abilities are known to the government also wants you to give the departments where you can work at the best level. So, diversity is the very first thing, but diversity cannot be the only thing that can give you a motivation. Financial sustainability is again a good thing. This job gives me financial sustainability. Any other job can give that sustainability, but again, in civil services, you start at the class 1 level of the jobs of Government of India, and a good salary, a decent salary, which can give a good living to your family, to your parents, to your would-be children. So, financial stability for my family, for my children, for my parents is good. And financial stability and sustainability does not only mean the salary, it also includes the fringe benefits. You always get good housing options, good accommodations. You always get good medical facilities. You always get good educational facilities for your children. So, if the package is counted, the salary is not a big issue. In private sector, you can get better salaries easily, but if you compare the total package of civil servant with the total package of a private individual, generally you will find that financial sustainability of civil servants is better than the private individuals. So that is an attraction, and you should be very clear about this. You should be very honest about this. Third, you can say that I want to contribute for the development of my country, and I believe if I get some power of decision making, I can give my contribution properly. Don't say I want power, I am hungry for power. Don't say that. Just say, because I want to contribute for the development of the country, and I think if I am given power to take decisions about this, I would be better equipped to do such things which I believe I should do. And if I am not having the power, I think I will not be able to give more contribution to my nation or my society or whatever. If these three things are said about the service, this is sufficient that your service is good. And secondly, sometimes you can give an emotional touch to the answer. An emotional touch is generally a good touch which helps you getting good marks in the interview. Like, you can tell a story, maybe a real story, maybe the story which you have created. Like, I know many people, many students who come to BIS or IPS, they have the stories, real stories. One would say, when I was a very small child, in my school festival, the collector of the district came as a chief guest. And the kind of respect he was enjoying there, everyone was after him. And the kind of respect he was having there, and the kind of works he did for the district, and the kind of respect people used to give him, not only because he was the DM, but because he was a dedicated, committed DM. I found this is what I should get in life. And because I had seen a DM or SP having a lot of respect, having a lot of esteem, self-esteem, and the contribution for the society, I thought I should do something like this. I discussed with my parents, I discussed with my teachers, that the kind of respect they are enjoying, is that possible for me to enjoy in any method, maybe in any profession? And my parents, my village people, my elders, my teachers, my friends, everyone suggested me that if you are passionate to get such kind of respect, if you are passionate to do great deeds for the district, for your state, your nation, then the only way for doing all those things is to get into civil services. So I came to know about civil services in the childhood, and my childhood dream has always led me to take my decisions, even my academic decisions, in this path only, in this direction only. The story can be different as well. When I was in the 8th class, one of the very senior students from my school only got into IAS, and my school invited him in a function as a chief guest. He spoke in the prayer meeting, and he spoke so well. Not only me, a lot of students from my school were so much motivated, so much inspired from his speech, that we decided to do something big. And something big in our dictionary, in our vocabulary, was getting into IAS. So in a way, this was my childhood dream. When I became an adult, when I became mature, then this emotive reason disappeared gradually, and these cognitive reasons came in the front. And right now, if I am wanting to be an IAS officer, my basic reason is I want to have a basic financial stability, which I can get in other jobs as well. But this combination is not available in any of the jobs which our country can offer to me. So that is why I want to be a civil servant, and in civil services, I want to be an IAS officer. They can ask you, if you don't get into IAS, you become an IPS officer or you become an IRS officer. In IPS and in IRS like services, you don't get such diversity. Then what would you do? So the answer to this question is, diversity in IAS is inherent, is inbuilt. In other civil services, diversity is not inherent, but a lot of deputations are possible. I have talked to many people who are working in services, and I have seen people, like even in UPSC only, right now the chairperson of UPSC is not an IAS officer, he comes from Indian Postal Services, Mr. Arvind. So nowadays, it's very easy for the members of civil services, if they are performing good, they can always request the government, and government generally tends to give them deputations as per their interests and abilities. So even if I am IPS, I can get into IB, I can get into CBI, I can get into RAW, sometimes I can go to Interpol, even sometimes like there is a very famous film, Purva. I think the name of the film is Purva. That is about an IPS officer from Telangana who had interest in education of the women, especially of the girl child. He demanded the CM to give him deputation in education department. Being an IPS officer, generally no one demands such deputations, but he demanded. And CM used to respect him. He gave the deputation. And then he created the history. At that time, Telangana was, I think, not born. That time it should have been Andhra Pradesh only. But that all story is given in that film, that how an IPS officer went into education department, created awareness about the girl education in villages, and from that particular movement, a girl, probably called Purva, created history. She went to Mount Everest in the earliest age, which was the record at that time. So if you have passion in any field, and by chance your service is not that service, you can always go for deputations, and the government is always happy to give deputations to the persons who are dedicated, who are compassionate, and who want to do something for the country, for the state. Now the third question is, why should we select you? Again, there are 2 points in this question. First of all, be honest. Being honest, I know I can never claim that I should be an IAS officer. I know about myself. But how can I know about my competitors? Like UPSC is taking interviews of around 2000 people. Out of those 2000 people, 180 are going to be the IAS officers. How can I claim, without knowing the other 1999 people, how can I claim that I am the best or I am one of the best 180? I cannot claim, I cannot say. So what I cannot say, what I cannot claim, I should not tell them that I am the best. This seems to be very ridiculous when you say, sir, I am the best, I know I am the best. This argument doesn't have any footing, any ground. The premise of the argument is fake, faulty. So don't speak about yourself so much which is not believable to the person sitting in your front. Why should we select you? You should be honest. You should be modest. You say, sir, as far as I know, for being a good civil servant, it needs some aptitude and some virtues or attributes. A good civil servant does have a combination of attitude and virtues or attributes suitable for the civil services. To the extent I have read from the syllabus of civil services, like in prelims exam, we have an exam called CSAT, that is civil services aptitude test. In the main exam, we study a paper called Ethics, Integrity and Aptitude. In that paper, we understand what is aptitude. We also understand what are civil service values, which are civil service attributes. So from that, what I understand is, for being a good civil servant, one has to be honest and a man of integrity. One. Secondly, he should have or she should have a sense of neutrality and objectivity. As far as some moral values are concerned, he or she should be compassionate for the ones who are downtrodden or who are deprived. He or she should have dedication for his work. He should not take his job as a job. He should take his job as a dedication, as a commitment. These are some of the values or some of the attributes a civil servant needs to have to be a very good civil servant. And as far as I know about myself, as far as my parents, my friends, my teachers have taught me about myself, I am of the view that I am having these values as the inherent values of my personality. Other than this, one has to be hardworking if if I am given the task of bringing a district into the mainstream, that is a weak district, that is a poor district, and if I am supposed to work day and night to bring that district in the mainstream of development, I cannot work from 10 to 6. I cannot work from 9 to 5. I have to be 24/7 in working mode. And I am hardworking. I can work to any extent if I am motivated enough to work in that field. So being a hard worker also need to be a good level of patience or perseverance. So I believe I have patience and perseverance to the extent is required to be a good civil servant. As far as the aptitude is concerned, I have good analytical skills. So I can analyze the data to understand the problems of a certain area. I can also analyze the various options available for the development. And the basic reasoning skills, basic analytical skills, basic data interpretation skills, basic mathematics, basic common sense, which is required for decision making. I'm a good decision maker. I make the decisions very quickly and generally my decisions are comprehensive and accurate. So, I'm telling you in detail, you are not supposed to speak so much in the interview. But having known these points, you will be speaking two or three things which are most appropriate in your case. So, you would say, the confidence that I have that I should be selected for civil services comes from the fact or from the opinion of my parents, my teachers, my friends that I possess all the attributes and the aptitude which is required to be a good civil servant. I am hardworking, I have perseverance, I have dedication, I am compassionate, I am having neutrality, objectivity, integrity, and also the analytical skills. You should use the skills in the last. You should initially focus on the virtues or attributes. And also I have the decision-making abilities, I have the analytical skills. And I think the combination of these abilities is the thing that make a civil servant a good civil servant. So, this is my belief about myself. I don't know am I able to convince you or not, but this is my belief about myself. But on the same track, you should say one more thing. You should say, sir, I won't insist that I should be selected. Out of 2000 candidates, only 180 have to be selected for IAS. Only around 800 are to be selected for civil services. This is my perception about myself. And I believe I am the right person for being a civil servant. And I am able to say this because I have seen many other civil servants as well. Many of my friends, many of my seniors are civil servants. And when I sit with them, when I talk to them, general mentality is that we compare with the people who are more successful than us. So, they are my reference groups. And I generally believe that out of the 10 people I know in civil services, I am equivalent to at least 5 or 6, maybe 2 or 3 are better than me. They are very good ranks also. They have good experience of service also. Maybe after a few years of service experience, I would also be a mature person like them. But again, I believe that I am from the same category from which they come. So, this is not overestimation about myself, but I don't also want to underestimate myself. This is my belief about myself. But still, I do not know my other competitors. Maybe they are better than me. And if you find them to be better than me, I don't have any reason to say that I should be selected. I don't want an unfair selection. I want to present myself as a candidate. I want to join civil services. And if it is believed by the interview board that I am the right person, I should be selected. My belief is this. But again, I cannot claim that I am the right person or I am the best person. I don't claim. I won't claim. So, these are the three main tricky questions which the interview board starts the discussion with generally. And there are so many questions, maybe hundreds of questions. We'll be having more discussions, we'll be having more videos on these questions. You are again requested to write down in the comment box the questions you think you should have the answers, and we'll try, our team will try to present the maximum answers to your questions. I hope this video will be useful for you, and please give your comments. Thanks a lot.